Hello and welcome to worship today. As you can see, I still have my sling, but hopefully we'll be getting rid of it in the next couple of days. My name is Andrew, this is my wife Tracy, and together we're privileged to lead the Salvation Army in Southend-on-Sea. Today in the UK is Candidate Sunday. This is a day when we are encouraged to promote Salvation Army officership as a potential vocation to those who might be open to God's calling in this way. It's also a day when we look at our own commitment to God.
That's right. Not all of us will receive a call from God to leave our homes and go to the training college, but sometimes we forget that we are all called to serve God and to share his good news as effectively as we can. Our opening song this week asks the question, who is on the Lord's side? Who will serve the King? What's your answer going to be? Let's sing together.
Tracy's going to pray with us, and she's going to be specifically asking God to make us sensitive to his voice. The two songs that we've chosen to help us during this time of prayer both remind us of our personal responsibility to serve God and his desire to empower us when it comes to living lives that draw others to Christ. The first song we're going to use is Brinley Boone's For Your Mission, Make Me Holy. You might notice that I've very slightly amended the words just to bring the language up to date a little bit. Then after Tracy has prayed, we're going to sing together, We Are the Hands of Christ.
let's join in prayer together. Father God, we thank you that we can come to you, that we can spend time with you in prayer. Mm-hmm. Father, that's something that we have to learn to do. Sometimes we go about it in the wrong way. Sometimes we come just with our list of desires and wants in life, and we just roll them off, Father, without even pausing for breath, without even considering that you want to speak to us in return. Prayer is a personal thing, and it's a wonderful tool that we can use to come close to you, where we can just pause and we can just listen to you, mm-hmm. and we can feel and sense your presence as we spend that time with you. Father, I don't believe that you have finished with the Salvation Army or with other denominations. I believe the church still has a place in this world of ours. And so, Father, I don't believe that you aren't calling people still today. But for whatever reason, people aren't responding to that call. And Father, we really do pray that people will listen to you and that they will be obedient, that they will not wait until they've done the things in their lives that they want to tick off, and then when that's all done, give everything else over to you, but that they will straight away offer up their lives to you, because it brings such fulfillment and blessing when we are obedient to your call. Father, we do pray that people will be called and that they will listen and that they will offer their services. And we thank you, Father, for the many people who continue to day in, day out, and each week through the Salvation Army serve you in lay positions. We wouldn't be able to operate without those volunteers. And so we thank you for the ministry that each of them has. And we pray, Father, that you will continue to call people into those positions that help our churches to run more effectively. And so now we do invite your Holy Spirit into this time with us, and we pray, Father, that we will sense him, we will sense his power and his provision. And we ask, Father, that we will just enjoy our time with you, and that you will be blessed by our contributions to you today. We ask this, Lord, in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to sing again, and we're using a video that Andrew created back in 2020. It's a song that you will know, but the video reminds us that there was a time when the Salvation Army, far from being old-fashioned, was at the cutting edge of evangelism. I hope you'll enjoy singing along with the joy strings. I want to sing it. Look out for a very young and glamorous Peter and Sylvia Dalziel, who join us every week for worship. And our Bible reading this week is brought to us in video form and is taken from John chapter 21 and its verses 1 to 14.
Afterwards, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I'm going out to fish," Simon Peter told them, and they said, "We'll go with you." So they went out and got into the boat. But that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore. But the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment round him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 meters. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there, with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread, and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead.
There will now be an opportunity for you to give electronically in the offering if you'd like to. And Dennis has chosen to play a song inspired by the Bible reading that we've just shared. It's written by Sidney Cox, and the words of the chorus say, "Follow thou me, he calls again, and I will make you fishers of men."
After we've had an opportunity to give financially, we have a recording from the International Staff Songsters singing with our own songsters when they came to Southend last month. Under their ministry, we enjoyed a truly wonderful weekend.
Amen.
The song is a modern version of John Gowan's "Spirit of the Lord in Me," which was written by Andrew Wicker. Benjamin Disraeli once said, there are three types of lies: lies, damn lies, and statistics. Whilst it is certainly true that statistics can be manipulated to say almost anything, that doesn't mean that we should ignore the truth that they display. Statistics show quite clearly that in the United Kingdom, the Salvation Army is in decline. I heard this week that there is a Western Territory with a large training college and teaching staff who, as things stand next year, will be welcoming one cadet into training. Let's take a while to allow that to sink in. A training college with classrooms, with a canteen, with a gymnasium, with a car park and an assembly hall, all waiting for one cadet. In the UK, we are doing a little bit better than that in numerical terms, but it's still true to say that the number of cadets entering the training college to become full-time officers is worryingly low. In the division where Andrew and I serve, when we move in July, there will be 10 corps without officers. At the moment, as you know, we have responsibility for leading 2 corps, and we are being followed in July by 1 officer. There's 2 ways we can respond to this current crisis. We can simply accept that the Salvation Army as an idea has had its day. We've had a good run and have been an effective part of God's forces for over 150 years, but the evidence at the moment overwhelmingly suggests that it is now time to pass the baton on to someone new. As Andrew indicated last week, this is not a view we share. We believe the only other response is to recognise that responsibility for decline rests not with God, but with ourselves. I shared the following statistics in a sermon on Candidate Sunday 5 years ago at Southend, and I think may have referenced them in one of our online meetings previously, but I thought it would be appropriate to share them again to remind ourselves of just how desperate our current situation is. Next month, Andrew and I are attending a reunion of the God's Messengers session. It will be 40 years since Andrew was commissioned. Let me just clarify though, I am going as his wife because in 1982 I was only 13. When Andrew entered the training college in 1980, he was one of 105 cadets, and the session the year before his numbered 102. When Andrew's mum entered the training college in 1958, she was one of 347 cadets. Now, that's Andrew telling me that figure, and I know he sometimes gets things wrong, so she might be ringing me once she's listened to this sermon just to correct the number. But it's worth remembering that in those days, training only lasted 9 months and not 18 months as it does today. And although it might not have been 347, it was a significant number in her session. These figures I'm quoting, for many people, are in living memory. When we compare these to the one cadet entering training that I mentioned earlier, they are frightening. We might feel a sense of pride in that cadets in training in the UK are still counted in double figures. But if we've gone from 350 to 100 in 32 years and from 100 to under 20 in 40 years, there isn't really much to be truly proud of. I recently heard a statistic that predicts on current performance that by the time Andrew retires in 2028, there will be 1 officer unit for every 10 Salvation Army centres. That, of course, assumes that none of those centres will close in the meantime. Between 1950 and 1960, soldiership in the Salvation Army was shrinking on average at a rate of 5%. Between 1960 and 1970, this had increased to 18%, During the next decade, we had shrunk by 20%. Between 1980 and 1990, this had increased to 24%, a rate of decline that continued up until the end of the 1990s. During the first decade of the new millennium, decline in soldiership was, somewhat encouragingly, only 23%. Of course, going back to what I said at the beginning about lies, damn lies and statistics, these figures don't include the number of adherents within the Salvation Army or those who choose not to formally belong but who have made the Salvation Army their regular place of worship. Having said that, however we dress it up, these statistics ought to alarm us. I dread to think what the latest figures would be based on the visible impact that lockdown has had on attendance. We've almost become hoarse in recent months, repeating the fact that the Salvation Army post-pandemic looks completely different from the one we left behind in March 2020. If we continue to decline at a rate of 25% per decade, then by the year 2050, the number of soldiers in the United Kingdom territory will be around about 5,000. Of course, if the rate of decline increases, and what we're seeing at the moment seems to suggest that it will increase significantly, then the number of soldiers will be even less than this. Understandably, this general decline has had a significant impact upon the number of Salvation Army officers being commissioned. In the last 30 years, the number of active officers in the UK has dropped by over 50%. Every year when farewell orders come out, more officers retire and divisional commanders have less and less active officers to deploy. Of course, these statistics relate to the United Kingdom, and I'm pleased to say that in other parts of the world, the Salvation Army is growing. In Pakistan, in India, in some parts of Africa and in some parts of South America, the Salvation Army is growing dramatically. There are also Salvation Army fellowships within the United Kingdom that buck this statistical trend. We can debate at length the reasons behind why people aren't offering for officership, but talking about it is not going to change things. Even if we were able to identify the reasons behind this decline, it would take a long time to bring about any meaningful change. The Salvation Army is a bit like an ocean-going liner. It needs a lot of space and time to turn around. Even if the numbers of Salvationists applying to become officers dramatically increased, these applicants would still need vetting, preparing, and ultimately training. We face an urgent problem that can only be fixed by a long-term solution. But there is something we can all do, whatever our age, ability, or even availability. The Salvation Army has always encouraged a belief in the priesthood of all believers and has consistently valued the contribution of all members of the faith community when it comes to sharing the gospel and serving others. In our Bible reading, the disciples have been fishing all night and caught nothing. Then Jesus tells them to cast their nets on the other side of the boat. Although they're reluctant, they do as Jesus tells them to, and they catch a multitude of fish. I think there are some elements within this story which will help us to find a solution to our current crisis. The disciples have fished and caught nothing. It's only when they follow Christ's command that they are successful. The Salvation Army has no right to exist unless God wills it to exist. We will catch men and women only if that is what God wants us to do. We will not grow as a denomination simply because the army suits our current needs. The Salvation Army was raised up to fulfil a very specific mission. And if either the need for that mission or our ability to fulfil it no longer exist, then perhaps our death is meant to be. But, as I've already said, this isn't something that Andrew or I are willing to accept. I see on a daily basis people who have fallen beyond the reach of the wider church and other agencies. Such people still come to us, and in the name of Jesus, we still attempt to meet their needs. Always, of course, looking for opportunities to share the gospel. Returning to our Bible reading, this event takes place after the crucifixion, and the disciples have gone back to doing what they have always done. In spite of 3 years' training under Jesus, in spite of all the miracles and healings they have witnessed, without the physical presence of Jesus, they have gone back to doing the only trade they know, fishing. Quite simply, if we want to live, if we want to grow, if we want to see the number of Salvation Army officers increase and the number of people coming to know Christ increase, then we can't simply go back to what we have always done. The problem is that all too often we want to change external things in the vain belief that if we put down a cornet and pick up a guitar, or leave off our uniforms and wear jeans, that we will automatically grow. Of course we need to change externally. Of course we need to change the way we do things. But unless these changes grow out of an internal change, they will achieve nothing. As Andrew quoted in his sermon last week from John Gowans, "He who without thee builds labours in vain." The hordes of people abandoning the Salvation Army are not queuing up to join other churches. They're not just abandoning the Salvation Army, they are abandoning their faith. When I talk about going back to what we've always done, perhaps what I should have said is going back to the things that we have never done. Let me explain. There is an immediate solution to our current problem, but it is a solution that will demand our personal commitment and support. It's always a dangerous thing to mix metaphors, but I want to just quickly refer to another biblical passage about growth, which has nothing to do with fishing. I'd like to refer to Matthew chapter 13 and the parable of the sower. I'm not going to read the parable to you because most of you will be familiar with it. Suffice to say that Jesus uses the way in which a farmer sowed seed to illustrate the way God spreads his word among his people. We're familiar with the seed that falls among the thorns, that falls on stony ground or on shallow ground. But I want to draw our attention today to verse 8, where Jesus says, "Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let them hear." When we think of ourselves in relation to the parable of the sower, what kind of ground do we think we are? Are we stony ground? Are we shallow ground? Do we, metaphorically speaking, attempt to be Christians among the thorns of worldly distraction and anxiety? Or do we consider ourselves to be good soil, into which good seed has fallen? If we consider ourselves to be good ground, then we need to ask ourselves the question, where is the crop? When we talk about doing things the way we have always done them, we need to accept that in the past, we have had a tendency to depend upon activities and initiatives led by others for growth, and have refused to accept any personal responsibility for sharing the good news about Jesus. Today, I have shared some frightening statistics, which have resulted in some even scarier predictions. But I've left the most frightening prediction to the end. Unless individuals within the church start to take seriously the command to share the good news of Jesus with their friends, the church will die. This is not an exaggeration. This is not fear-mongering. This is a simple fact backed up by Scripture. Every single one of us needs to ensure that we are good soil into which good seed has fallen. This is the only way to guarantee growth. What is it that compels us to share the good news about Jesus? The only thing that will provide us with the motivation, power, and creativity to talk about Jesus with those who don't know him in a way they can understand is love. We need to be driven by our love for God and our love for those who don't know him. In his song, "Except I Am Moved with Compassion," Albert Osborne says the following: "The Saviour of men came to seek and to save the souls who were lost to the good. His spirit was moved for the world which he loved with the boundless compassion of God. And still there are fields where the labourers are few, and still there are souls without bread, and still eyes that weep where the darkness is deep, and still straying sheep to be led. Except I am moved with compassion, how dwelleth thy spirit in me? In word and in deed, burning love is my need. I know I can find this in thee." It is a hard and difficult to swallow truth, but the future of the church, the possibility of renewal and revival, as Andrew reminded us last week, rests with us. If we love God and if we love others, then we will be compelled to share that love with everyone we come into contact with. I'd like to conclude this morning by reading you a quote from a book written by Commissioner Samuel Logan Brengle called Ancient Prophets. Much of what he says is true of our current circumstances. It seems that the only thing he got wrong was that we would continue to fill our training colleges from among our own ranks. I know that some of you will have heard this quote before, but it is worth repeating. "The army is so thoroughly organised and disciplined, so wrought into the life of nations, so fortified with valuable properties and on such a sound financial basis, that it is not likely to perish as an organisation. But it will become a spiritually dead thing if love leaks out. Love is the life of the army. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us. But if love leaks out, we shall lose our crown. We shall have a name to live and yet be dead. We may still house the homeless, dole out food to the hungry, punctiliously perform our routine work, but the mighty ministry of the Spirit will no longer be our glory. Our musicians will play meticulously. Our songsters will revel in the artistry of song that tickles the ear but leaves the heart cold and hard. Our officers will make broad their phylacteries and hobnob with mayors and councilmen and be greeted in the marketplace. But God will not be among us. We shall still recruit our ranks and supply our training garrisons with cadets from among our own young people. But we shall cease to be saviours of the lost sheep that have no shepherd. God bless you.
Well, thank you so much once again for joining with us this week. I hope that in the busyness that lies ahead, you will remember that whether we are officers or not, we are all called to share the good news of Jesus with the people around us. I know that sometimes the devil makes us feel nervous when it comes to sharing our faith, but remember the words that the songsters sang earlier. Who is it tells me what to say? That's the Spirit of the Lord in me. Our closing song is On We March With the Blood and the Fire, a song that reminds us that the Lord's command to go into the world and preach the gospel unto all is just as true today as when his first disciples heard this mighty call.
Then our benediction this week is one which I have never sung before, written by Harry Reid to the tune The Old Hundredth. The words say, Lord of all glory and of grace, reign over me. Then to play us out, we have a recording of the Stockholm Temple Band with Eric Silverberg's Fill the World with Music, which contains the line, we're going to sing, sing, sing the gospel story. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. God bless indeed. You. Hallelujah indeed. God bless you. And until next time, stay safe.